Okay, so hello and welcome to Lesson 10 of GCSE Geography. We're going to be looking today at coastal processes and landforms. This is going to follow a similar format to when we looked at river processes and landforms. We're going to be looking at erosional processes and landforms that are created by erosion. We're going to be looking at transport processes, and we're going to be looking at deposition processes and landforms that are created by a combination of transport and deposition. So we're going to activate our prior knowledge on the four main types of erosion: your hydraulic action, abrasion, attrition, solution. They're the same processes happening on the coastline as happen in rivers, because it's water wearing away and removing the material. We're going to add to that prior knowledge on transport, deposition and erosion, and apply that to explain the different landforms, the different shapes that we see around our own coastline in Wales and coastlines elsewhere in the world. So if you pause the video here a second, go ahead and put today's title, Coastal Processes and Landforms, and we'll get started. Okay, so a few images to kind of get us going. This is a coastal landform down in Pembrokeshire. So originally, the cliff face would have been complete all the way out here. There wouldn't have been this gap here. There wouldn't have been this gap here. There wouldn't have been this gap here. What's happened here is different erosion processes to create a sequence called cave arch stack stump formation. And a particularly famous example of this is the 12 Apostles in Australia. So these stacks and stumps would have originally all been part of one full cliff face. And then we've got a slightly more familiar image, perhaps, which is Three Cliffs Bay down in Gower. This headland sticking out here and the bay that's been created here, all of these things are a product of erosion by the sea. The sea is wearing away the beaches, it's also wearing away the cliffs. Okay, so it moves the sand and it removes the rock. Obviously, one of the main challenges facing the world at the moment being climate change, we're concerned about sea level rise and how that could accelerate, how that could speed up the coastal processes around the edges of our land that we live on, really. So we're going to look today at how erosion, transport and deposition creates different landforms. And then next lesson, which will be the final lesson of theme one, we're going to look at how we can manage the erosion to protect the land that we live on as we're facing climate change and sea level rise, and therefore increased rates of erosion, and the land that we're living on is collapsing into the sea. So job one, subheading, coastal erosion processes. Now, if we were in school, I would be encouraging you to write these down again, even though they're the same as the processes that happen in the river and we wrote them down during that lesson. Doesn't do any harm to get it down again in this context. So you've got hydraulic action, which is the force of the water itself. So the waves will be pressing into the cliff face, and wherever there's a crack or a weakness, it will force the air in ahead of the wave. And that air pressure can be so immense that it actually starts to force the rock apart, as does the force of the water itself. We've got abrasion. This is the kind of sandpaper action one, where the particles in the waves, as the waves crash against the cliff, all those bits of rock and sand and pebbles will wear away the cliff like a sandpaper action. We've got attrition, where the particles in the waves crash into each other and break into smaller pieces. And finally, we've got solution, where the acidity or the alkaline levels of the water would perhaps sometimes dissolve the cliff. This is particularly common in areas of limestone or chalk. They are calcium carbonate based rocks, so they're very easily dissolved by quite weak acids. Another issue related to climate change is our oceans are becoming more acidic as they're heating up slightly. So that can increase the rates of erosion due to solution. I've put corrosion there in brackets. There's a video you're going to watch later on where they use the word corrosion instead of solution. Just to give you a heads up, they mean exactly the same thing. So if you want to write these four down again, I would recommend it under the subheading coastal erosion processes. Pause the video here a minute and do that. Okay, so how do these erosion processes shape our coastline? Here's some images that are local to us. You've got Caswell Bay, and you've got Langland Bay, right? And in between the bays, there's land that still sticks out, okay? So you've got a sticky out bit, kind of sticky in bit, your bay. And then it comes out again, and then it goes in again. And then it goes out again, and then it goes in again. Okay, you can see that here. Out, in. Out, in. Okay. Oh, the bits that stick out are... Hold on. Technical difficulties. The bits that stick out are called headlands. The bits that go in are called bays. Let's get rid of this. There we go. These are created because our coastline isn't all the same rock type. You get areas of softer rock and you get areas of harder rock. That's called a disconcordant coastline. Okay, what we're going to do is draw a diagram imagining we're looking down on this area from above, like a bird's eye view. Okay, so imagine we're flying over the coastline. You've got areas of harder rock and areas of softer rock. If you stripped away all the soil on top of the cliff, you'd see bands of hard rock and soft rock alternating. That's the disconcordant coastline. There's your cliff edge, and here's the sea and the waves crashing into the cliffs. What do you predict will begin to happen? Precisely, okay? Now, it's not that hard rock doesn't erode at all. It does. It's still affected by hydraulic action, still affected by abrasion, still affected by solution, brackets, corrosion, but just at a far slower rate than the soft rock. So what happens is the soft rock gets eroded much more quickly to create bays, and the harder, more resistant bands of rock erode far more slowly. So they remain sticking out to create headlands. What I'd like you to do is just pause the video here a minute, put a subheading, headlands and bays, and make your own version of this diagram, including those two annotations, into your books, please. Doesn't need to be massive, okay? It's quite simple. You should be able to draw it yourselves. Okay, so we're going to take this a step further. I've gone quite quickly through that because it's fairly straightforward. What I'd like you to imagine next is that you're maybe down in the bay looking at the edge of the headland. All right, so you've got this area of hard rock sticking out into the sea. All right, now what happens is sometimes the sea at high tide will start cutting into the front of that headland. And it creates something called a wave cut platform. And on wave cut platforms, you have rock pools. Now, I tried to convert this video, but because it's embedded in a web page, my usual conversion hacks wouldn't let me do it. So the original PowerPoint is in the study zone. Copy and paste this website or type it in from by pausing and minimizing this video if you like. Watch this video. It's a few minutes long, and the second half of the video starts to go into cave arch stack stump, which we'll come on to later, so feel free to watch that bit as well. But the first half will explain to you how wave cut platforms are created. So pause here a minute, load up that video on BBC Bite Size, and have a watch. Okay, so what you will have seen being created there is a real life or animated version of the three-step diagram that I've got here. Okay, so high water, low water, that's what the HW and the LW mean. So what happens at high tide or high water? The waves, now waves only happen on the surface, and waves are created by the wind, not by the moon, that's the tides. Okay, so the waves on the water surface will start to crash into the edge of the headland, the front edge of the cliff face, all right? And that will begin to erode here. It doesn't erode all the way down, because in this case, it's the waves doing the erosion. It's not the ocean currents deeper down. So that surface erosion creates a little notch here, okay? Now, as you can imagine, this area all above the notch is now unsupported. So what will happen is all of that rock will collapse into the sea. The waves will remove it, and another notch will be created by the waves on the sea surface. Remember, erosion doesn't happen all the way down. It's not being done by the deeper ocean currents. It's being done just by the surface waves. That's why it only cuts in this bit. So it will create another notch here. That bit will collapse. And then it will create another notch. And that bit will collapse. So basically what's happening is the edge of the cliff used to be all the way out here, the edge of the headland, and it retreats with each collapse. And what you end up with along here is a platform that has literally been cut by the waves. So it's called a wave cut platform. And this is what it looks like in real life. So if you can visualize that originally, this cliff face would have been all the way out here. That marks the original boundary of the edge of the cliff. The waves cut a notch, it collapsed. The waves cut a notch, the cliff collapsed. The waves cut a notch, the cliff collapsed. And so on, until eventually, at the moment, the cliff face is all the way back here. Now, this won't continue forever and the land disappears. This process can only happen inland as far as the tide can reach. So it will stop eventually. The tide can only reach a certain point. Where we're concerned, obviously, is if the tidal reach increases because sea level rises as a result of the ice caps melting due to climate change. But that's a tangent for another day. So what I'd like you to do is put a subheading, wave cut platforms and rock pools. I'll come back to rock pools in a moment. And I'd like you to make your own simplified three-step diagram of this. Okay, literally put that into your books. Take as much space as you need. Pause the video here a moment and do that, please. Okay, so the rock pool element, it's not a massive part of the specification. It's highly unlikely you're going to get a question that asks you specifically how rock pools are created. But just to touch on it briefly, and you can listen again to this description if you want to just put down a couple of sentences as to how it's formed in your own words. As you can see, where the cliff edge has collapsed, a wave cut platform isn't completely flat. You've got all kinds of little dips and weaknesses in here. So each time the tide comes in, it will bring with it water and it will bring with it bits of pebbles and sand and various particles. And as the waves kind of slosh in and out over the wave cut platform, those pebbles and particles will get trapped in little potholes or little gullies or whatever. And as the waves slosh back and forward, so do the pebbles inside the potholes. And it creates almost like a little rattling around motion where the pebbles and sand being sloshed around by the waves in a dip or a pothole will kind of, by abrasion, wear that dip or pothole larger and larger and larger. And that's how you get rock pools. I had put a larger version of that three-stage diagram down here for you if you were struggling to see the annotations, but hopefully you should have been able to get those from the previous slide. Okay, so moving on, that video you watched a moment ago, it started in the second half to talk about cave arch stack stump formation. So we're sticking with headlands. So imagine if you can that this is a headland, okay? This area coming in here, and if you can visualize it coming around, would be a bay. There'd be another bay on the other side of this headland, okay? So this is kind of like a finger of hard rock sticking out into the sea. And these areas of headland, they do have weaknesses in them. And the ocean or the sea will find that weakness and it will begin to erode, okay? It'll find a little crack, and it will start to erode. That crack will get bigger and bigger until it creates a cave. And eventually that cave will get deeper and deeper until it cuts all the way through the headland and forms like an archway. Now the top of that arch is unsupported and will eventually collapse into the sea. So it will leave a bit of the headland out here, and that's called a stack. And eventually that stack will be weathered and eroded by high tides, by storms, and get worn down until it's only little. It's called a stump. Okay, so you get a crack, then a cave, then an arch, then a stack, then a stump. And the process repeats itself at various points along the headland. This animation will help you to visualize what I've just said.
Somewhere beyond the sea, somewhere waiting for me, my lover stands on golden sands and watches the ships that go sailing. Somewhere beyond the sea, she's there watching for me. If I could fly like birds on high, then straight to her arms, I'll go sailing.
All right, bit of Frank Sinatra there for you as well. So that's how this sequence is created on a headland. Now, those of you that came to Iceland, when we got off at the Black Sand Beach that day, quite a few of you recognised this in the distance. So I was quite impressed with that. Right. On your handout, you've got six images, A, B, C, D, E, F. Okay. What I'd like you to do is hold the phone. Right. Turn a page sideways in your book and split it into six sections. All right. So split it across the middle with a line and then down with two more lines. The six images that you've got on your handout, A, B, C, D, E, F, at the moment, they are not in the right order. I want you to go back and rewatch that video as many times as you need. Try to cut them out and put them in the right order in these spaces. Okay, so this first one will be an almost complete headland. There might be some erosion starting to happen, maybe creating a cave. And then you'll have the cave becoming an arch. The first arch collapses to create a stack. And then the process starts to begin again, and the stack's being eroded downwards, create a stump, and so on, so on. Okay, see if you can order the images correctly into a new sequence. If you're concerned you're going to stick them down there in the wrong order, the answers are on the next slide, but pause the video here a minute and try to work it out yourself first. Okay, so that's the order they were in, A, B, C, D, E, F. This is the correct order. Okay, so there's your complete headland. The waves have found a crack and started to create a cave, and then eventually that cave has cut all the way through to the other side, creating the first archway. The top of the arch has then collapsed, leaving us the first stack. There's that first stack, minding its own business, but the waves have found another area of weakness and eroded to create a cave and cut all the way through to form a second archway. Now that second archway will then also collapse because it's unsupported, and to create a second stack. In the meantime, the first stack has been battered and eroded down to create a stump. And then the waves find another weakness and the process begins again. You've got a third archway forming here. There's your second stack, and there's your first stump. What you're going to do next is, you'll notice obviously on the layout here, you've got areas for writing underneath where you've stuck C, E, D, F, A, B was the correct order. I'm going to give you six annotations that are jumbled up. Look out for connectives like firstly, secondly, the final, in the beginning. All right, I've even underlined them to draw your attention to them, to put the correct annotation under the correct image. pause the video here and do that now, please. Okay, so what you should have, the finished product, is a sideways page with six images stuck down and six annotations underneath them to beautifully explain the process by which cave arches, stacks and stumps are formed by coastal erosion through a headland. Okay, now if we were in class, that would be pretty much 1 hour, maybe 1 hour and a bit. This whole PowerPoint, if we were doing it in class, actually stretches over a double, sometimes even into a little bit of a triple. So if you want to take a bit of a break here, by all means, go ahead and do so. Right, then we're going to move on to coastal transport. So the headlands and bays, the cave arch, stack, stump, that's all to do with erosion, the wearing away and removal of material. Now, once that material is out in the sea, it gets eroded and eroded and eroded, smaller and smaller and smaller, mostly by attrition, into sand particles, and that's what creates our beaches. It's various bits of broken down shell and material that originally was part of the land somewhere. Now, the sand on our beach, it doesn't just sit in one place. It gets moved along. It gets transported by a process called longshore drift. And this is all to do with waves. Now then, like I mentioned earlier, waves are not created by the moon, that is the tides. Waves are created by wind blowing across the sea's surface. Okay, now the waves pretty much anywhere in the world, but particularly in Britain, they normally are created at an angle. In Britain, it's usually from the southwest. Okay, the direction the wind comes from, that's called the prevailing wind direction. Our prevailing winds are southwesterly. Okay, they come from down here. So they approach the beach at an angle and the waves wash up the beach. And as they do so at an angle, they take these little red dots, which are supposed to represent sand particles, with them. We call that process swash. The waves then retreat back out to sea, dragging the sand particles with them. But they move directly this time at right angles to the beach. That's called the backwash. The waves swash up again and move the particle, backwash, swash, backwash, swash, backwash. Okay, so if you imagine, stressful. If you imagine that what's happening here is actually the particles are being moved from this end of the beach down along the shoreline, long shore, by the waves. So eventually what will happen is there'll be no beach up here. All right. Now that's not good if you have tourist economy in the area and are relying on seasonal visitors to a really beautiful beach. There'll be no beach left. So quite often what we do is we put coastal defences in place, and we're going to focus on this a lot more next lesson. On this image, I've got a couple of groins. All right, these are, you'll have seen them on beaches, little wooden walls that stick out into the sea. Sometimes they're made of stone. And what they do is they trap the longshore drift particles. So instead of going swash, backwash, and the sand continuing to move along here, instead what you have happening is swash, 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 and it traps all the sand. And you can then redeposit it back on the beach using diggers or whatever. It stops it all from being transported away. This video will help to explain that in a little bit more detail.
Hello everyone. Today we're going to be looking at a coastal process. And this coastal process is called longshore drift. Now, longshore drift is a type of movement of sediment or particles from one side of the beach to the other. And it's very important that we draw this diagram from a top-down perspective. Now, the most important thing in this diagram and the factor that actually causes longshore drift is the wind direction, in this case, the prevailing wind direction, which you can see labeled on the diagram. The prevailing wind direction will cause waves to move in exactly the same direction as the prevailing wind. And they will pick up particles from one side of the beach and they will move them up the beach due to the swash that rolls up the beach. And when they reach the top of the swash, they will roll back down the beach as backwash. Now, when you're drawing this, it's very important the swash movement follows the wave direction, because that's the main thing that influences it. However, the backwash movement is influenced by gravity and therefore is vertically back down the beach. So this process continues over and over again every time a wave breaks on the beach. And eventually what will happen is that the particles will move from one side of the beach, in this case the left-hand side of the beach, to the right-hand side of the beach, following this movement of longshore drift. Thank you very much for watching and have a really great day.
Okay, so go back and re-listen again if you need to, but what I'd like you to do is put a subheading, coastal transport, longshore drift, make your own version of this diagram in the middle of a page with room to put annotations around it. I've done a couple for you, but I would like you to put in this one what swash is and what it does to the sand particles, what backwash is and what it does to the sand particles, and how groins help to prevent the entire beach from being eroded by, from being removed, transported away by longshore drift. So pause the video here a moment and do that, please. I definitely would recommend using colour on your diagram in this instance if you have them, because there's quite a lot of lines and things going on there. I've put an image here of the groins I was talking about just to help you visualise them. You don't have a photo in your resource pack, but you don't need it. It's just there for illustration purposes. Okay, so the last thing we're going to cover, we've covered erosion, we've covered transport, we're going to go on to deposition. Now, this will look very familiar. We've talked about deltas before, we've talked in detail about the Nile Delta, so I want you to just put a subheading, depositional coastal landforms deltas, cut out this image and annotate what's going on around it, okay? So I've put a few complete annotations there for you and others that you should be able to use your prior knowledge to fill in yourself. So sediment is eroded and brought down from the mountains by the river, okay? Secondly, the river velocity begins to slow because as a river reaches the sea or the ocean, it widens out at the mouth. So all the water that was in a narrow channel is now flowing in a much, much wider channel. So the river velocity begins to slow because the pressure drops really rapidly. It's gone from flowing in a narrow space to flowing in a wide space. And when the pressure drops, the speed drops. And when the speed drops, the energy of the river decreases and causes the river to deposit, to drop all of the sediment that it's carrying. And that's what forms the delta. The land on the delta is super fertile because that river has been flowing over the landscape, not only picking up mud and sand and other various particles, but also there will be lots of decomposed vegetation in here. There'll be sometimes dead animals, dead fish, whatever, organic material. So the land on a delta is very, very fertile because it's sand and mud and minerals from the land, but also organic material from the land as well. To cross the delta, the river has to split into smaller channels. That's called braiding. And eventually the river then reaches the other side of the delta, flowing out to sea at the mouth. All right. I've rushed through that fairly quickly. If you just copy and complete your own version in your books, because we have talked quite a bit about deltas before. So pause the video here and go ahead and do that. Take as much space in your book as you need. Okay, so last thing for today is something called a spit. This is brand new and it is a little bit tricky to visualize, okay? A spit is a combination of transport and deposition. And they're created where you have a headland and a bay, all right? Now what happens is there's your headland, there's your bay, there'd be another headland here, and then another bay, and so on and so on. But the crucial part is where you have a river coming down into the bay. All right. What's happened here is longshore drift. So on the other side of this headland would be another bay in here. If you pretend that image isn't there for a moment, there'd be another bay here. And what has happened is longshore drift, the swash and backwash, swash and backwash, swash and backwash, has pulled the sand material out of that bay and around the edge of this headland. Okay. And it deposits it on the other side of the headland. Over time, as more and more material is pulled out of the neighbouring bay and around the headland by longshore drift, that deposition will build up and form what's called a spit. Okay, so that bit there, in real life, looks like this bit here. Okay, so what you've got going on off the edge of this image, there's a river here coming down to meet the bay here. Like the river here coming down to meet this bay. But the material from the neighbouring bay has been dragged out and across by longshore drift. Out and across by longshore drift. And this area here is the spit. Now then, behind the spit is sheltered from all the wind and waves battering the coastline from the ocean, from the sea. And what that means is, as the river flows down and out to sea at its mouth, the material that it's carrying, because this area here is really sheltered, as it deposits its load, all the sand and silt and stuff, it builds up behind the spit. And this area here is kind of full then of mud and sand and silt, but also salty water because you're at the mouth of the river where it meets the sea. And that creates something called a salt marsh. Over time, as the spit becomes more and more developed and more stable, vegetation quite often starts to grow on it, as you can see here. Okay, and people actually love to live on these once they become stable enough. As you can imagine, the view out here is absolutely stunning. The most famous example of this in Britain is an area called Sandbanks. Go on Zoopla on the internet and type in properties for sale in Sandbanks. I kid you not, it's one of the most expensive areas of the UK to live in. There's all kinds of celebrities and footballers living down there. It's absolutely stunning, but it is very vulnerable to coastal erosion. You've got to put lots of defences and things like that in place, which we'll come on to next lesson. Okay. So step one, you've got longshore drift pulling the sand out of the neighbouring bay and around the edge of the headland. Step two, longshore drift continues to pull that sand out across the opening of the next bay, and that creates a spit. The winds and things like that often cause the edge of the spit to kind of like hook around. That's called the hook, funnily enough. Next step, as this river is coming down into this bay, the material that it's carrying, because this area is sheltered from the wind and the waves coming in from the coast, very sheltered, so there'll be no erosion, lots of deposition happening here, and all the material builds up to form like a salty, boggy area of marshland called a salt marsh. All right. Here is a little video explaining what I've just said that hopefully will help you out a little bit.
Hello everyone, in this video we're going to be looking at a depositional coastal feature. This depositional feature is called a spit, and it forms on a discordant coast. The discordant coast is the one that we looked at on a previous video, where you have alternative bandings of hard rock and soft rock, and you get bays and headlands that form. In this specific diagram, we're going to be marking in two bays and two headlands. Now, it's important that in one of the bays we put a river, because this river is going to help the formation of a spit. Without it, a spit could not form. Now, for the formation of a spit to occur, the main process that's occurring is deposition, but there is also quite a large element of transportation that's occurring. This transportation occurs due to the prevailing wind, which you can see that I'm marking in on the left-hand side of the diagram. This causes the waves to move and to follow the same direction as the prevailing wind, and because it's following the same direction of the prevailing wind, and through the process of longshore drift that I'm going to mark very shortly on this diagram, it transports sediment from the left-hand part of the diagram to the right-hand part of the diagram. This sediment that is slowly transported across the coast will eventually become deposited on the far side of the headland. The headland is not, this part is more sheltered and less affected by the waves and the wind, so therefore deposition occurs. Now every so often the wind direction can change. We call this change a secondary wind. And what this wind will therefore cause is it will cause the deposited material to move or to shift direction and to move inland a bit. This causes this formation that we see on spits called a hook to form. You can see the hook that's labeled in on the diagram. Now behind this spit, you have this area of very sheltered sea. And this gets a lot of deposition that occurs because of the river bringing sediment and also due to the sea. This type of area is often, you have a lot of vegetation that forms and you get a salt marsh that eventually forms in this area.
If at this point you would like to make your own version of this diagram in your books, that might actually be quite helpful as a good visualization. So pause it here a moment and do that if you wish. Not of that photograph, obviously, just of the illustration.
Now in the photo that you can see that I've just put in above the diagram, this is a real spit, and you can see that I'm labeling the different types of features that I've also labeled on the hand-drawn diagram below. Thank you very much for watching and have a really great day.
Okay, so last job for today, you'll be pleased to hear, and I think probably at this stage you might be feeling a little bit fed up, so I've pretty much done it for you, is to create an annotated photograph of how a spit is formed. So put a subheading, landforms formed by transport and deposition, spits, if you haven't done so already, because perhaps you made a little copy of the diagram from the video that we just watched, and cut and stick this image. It's on your resources, and I've put down the processes for you here. So we've got the longshore drift, the swash and backwash, swash and backwash, swash and backwash, that has pulled the sand out of the neighboring bay and around the headland, dragging it over the front of this bay to create the spit. Over time, as the size of the spit increases, secondary winds also create a hook curved edge here, and vegetation begins to grow, and the roots of that vegetation helps to stabilize the spit. Behind the spit is nice and sheltered. This is the ocean side. It's getting battered by coastal erosion. Nice and sheltered in here, and the material brought down by the river into this bay gets deposited here and builds up to form a salt marsh. And eventually, as it all becomes quite stable, people often like to develop that area and live on it. You get golf courses, quite high-end leisure facilities on there, as well as very expensive high-end housing and apartments as well. Perhaps you had a little look on Zoopla and saw some of the properties that I was mentioning down in Sandbanks in southern England. But because obviously this area is getting attacked by erosion, and the materials being transported by longshore drift, quite often you need a lot of coastal defences in areas like this. And that is the final lesson of theme one that we're going to talk about next lesson. So pause the video here, cut and stick that image and put the annotations down, please, underneath this subheading. Okay, and that is the end of lesson 10. We've done a lot of drawing today, a lot of annotating. We've got the four erosion processes and the headlands and bays, cave arch, stack stumps that they create. We've got the transportation of the sand along the beach through longshore drift and the spit that is created partly by that transportation and partly by the deposition of the river as it reaches the sea. And we've also had the delta that's created by deposition that we've talked about previously. As usual, any questions whatsoever, drop me an email. I hope your exercise book is starting to look really nice and full now of diagrams and colour and information and images. But if you need anything, don't be afraid to ask.